IVM.
I want to thank Intel for supporting our show. Do you remember last year when we spoke about how the Intel vPro platform is built for business? Well, I'm glad to say we've kicked it up a notch. That's right, Intel is back with a new and improved version of the platform. The new Intel vPro platform lets you do more of what you want and less of what you don't. So it's better for you and for your IT teams, who really are the backbone of keeping your work-from-home experience easy and enjoyable. I can safely say that the new vPro platform gives you more enterprise efficiency with less constraints. Visit intel.in/morewithvpro, that's VPRO, to discover how you can get more done with less waiting. If you're listening on the IVM Podcast Android app, click the link that's visible to you now.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. From June 7th, the fuel prices in India have gone up for consecutive 22 days. Petrol prices in Delhi, as well as the diesel prices, are in the range of 80 rupees per liter. Meanwhile, the global fuel demand has plummeted due to the lockdowns and due to the COVID-19 pandemic. So what explains the incongruity here? To unpack this and explain this to us, I have with me Pranay on today's show. I'm Utkarsh. So Pranay, can you explain and unpack this for us?
So Utkarsh, first of all, are you driving while you're there in Delhi? Are you using your vehicle?
No, I don't.
Yeah,
I'm staying put in home.
Yeah, so even I'm staying put in home. So it just shows that our demand at least has dropped. Generally, petrol and diesel prices, people think that they are inelastic, right? Because we require those, irrespective of the price, we require to spend on them in order to reach our offices, etc. So relatively inelastic compared to other goods. But what you're seeing in recent times is actually that the consumption itself has reduced because you and I and many people like us are not even going to the offices, right? So consumption has reduced. Now, in turn, this is not just happening with you and me, right? It's happening all across the world. And as a result, global fuel prices have plummeted, right? So for example, it was the Indian crude basket, which, you know, combines all these petrol, diesel and other petroleum products, that was priced at around $71 per barrel in around 2019-20 financial year beginning. And that came down to around $20 just a couple of months back. And now it is at around $40 per barrel. Okay, so from $71 per barrel at 2019-20 beginning, that is around April 2019, it has significantly dropped in a year, right? So now the drop is more than around 40%. But yet you see that the prices that you and I are paying are still around the same, right? You have not reduced. You are not paying for 50% less, definitely not. So why can that happen? There's only one reason. The reason is that the government's taxes have increased. So currently, in Delhi, for example, you are paying around what the amount that you pay to the petroleum, to the petrol pump, 2/3 of it is in the form of taxes. The remaining 1/3 is the actual price of that crude oil that you're paying. Rest all is in the form of one or the other form of taxes.
So out of this 80 rupees that I pay on the pump, 50 rupees, roughly 2/3 of it, is taxes.
Yes.
So how is the tax broken up between the union and the state governments?
Yeah. So there is a lot of complicated issues here, right? So basically, there is something called cascading of taxes. That means that we also pay taxes and then we end up paying taxes on those taxes as well. So there is one excise duty, there is a special additional excise duty, and then there are state government imposed VATs, value added taxes. So all of these are imposed on something called petrol and diesel. Unlike say the other goods where we have moved to GST, and that GST prevents cascading of these taxes, but petrol and diesel, because they are so lucrative and because the governments find it very easy to raise the prices of petrol and diesel, they are still not a part of GST. Okay, so all these things form a part of separate part where they can basically keep increasing these additional duties and special excise duties that I was talking about. Now, just to illustrate to you how that has happened is, so for example, on March 14, government had raised excise duty on petrol and diesel by around 3 rupees per liter. Okay? And that they were saying that this will give them additional 39,000 crore rupees in revenue. Okay? But they have discounted the fact that we are not even using those our vehicles. So I still don't have the numbers and the government won't put it out. But how much of that 39,000 crore they have made is not clear yet. Okay. But nevertheless, so what they did is they increased this 3 rupees per liter, right? And in that, what they did is it is divided into two parts. So this duty hike had rupees 2 increase. It was a part of the special additional excise duty. And there was rupee 1 increase in road and infrastructure cess. Okay. Now, this out of this 3 rupees, basically this 1 rupee which has increased in road and infrastructure cess, that cess only belongs to the union government. Okay, so cesses in general belong only to the union government. They are not shared with the states at all. Whereas that special additional excise duty is shared with the states in the form of financial devolution later on. Okay, so this is one part. Now, what that made things do is that hike actually raised the special additional excise duty to the maximum that was permissible in law back then, which was around rupees 10 in the case of petrol and rupees 4 in the case of diesel. So this was some law which was made so that the governments don't keep increasing their special additional excise duty forever. Now, here comes the interesting part. During that time, the government passed an amendment to the 8th schedule of the Finance Act, and that limit, which was rupees 10 in the case of petrol and rupees 4 in the case of diesel, was just increased by 8 rupees both. Okay, so now the government can freely increase special additional excise duty of rupees 8 in both petrol and diesel without requiring any permission from the parliament or anyone. Okay, so that is what was done in March around April, and those permissions were actually utilized recently, and that's why you see an increase in rupees 8 in petrol, diesel and all those prices, right? So this is, do you remember seeing this amendment, or do you remember noticing this when the government passed it in the parliament?
No, not at all. In fact, that's the thing. In spite of fuel prices being sticky issues with the citizens and with the population, you do not see these things happening in the parliament. They somehow do not come into the popular media.
Exactly. Right. So, Uprash, I think the reason for that is probably because this is a classic in public policy. We learn about Wilson's matrix, right? So if the benefits or the costs of any policy are dispersed across a large number of people, then they are unlikely to actually protest if it is a cost, or they are unlikely to bat for it strongly if it is a small benefit. So I think that's a similar case here. The government knows that it is spread over a large number of people, and the large number of people don't have a union, or they are not going to come together on the streets for this particular issue. So it uses these petrol and diesel prices as a cash cow. It can go on increasing it. And yeah, we don't even know that the government passed this act, right? And we just have to lump it.
Correct. So I'll actually come to the dispersed cost and what higher orders it can lead to in some time. But let me just point out to some numbers for context. Mm. So in April, during the lockdown, petrol consumption in India dived by 60% and diesel by 55%. Mm. Right. As you already said, the union government increased excise taxes in May by 10 rupees per liter and rupees 13 per liter on diesel. Mm. At the very beginning, only the oil marketing companies took the hit and they did not reduce their prices for margins. However, when the state government saw the union government increase the taxes, excise tax, they also increase their VAT to shore up their revenues. So an action by the union government led to a similar action by the state governments. So by June 6th, when the crude oil prices had regained into some what $40 per barrel, the OMCs had to increase their oil prices, and the consumer had to pay more and more prices. Now the thing with this is the governments here actually increase taxes to actually fill up their coffers when the global prices are low. But the problem is we do not see a rollback of these taxes when the prices actually return to their stable states.
Yeah, no, right? Absolutely. So see, basically we moved to this system called market determined prices back a few years back in petrol and diesel. Okay, so market determined prices should mean that when the global prices are low, the consumer pays a much lesser price. And when the global prices are high, which indicates scarcity at that time, we are going to pay higher, right? But what has happened is very sinister. This, it is not market determined prices at all. What the consumer ends up paying is basically something very different. So these market determined prices, so-called market determined prices in India, actually end up benefiting only the government. So what is done is basically whenever the prices of the global crude oil decreases, the government just increases this excise duty. So the consumer's total outgo, which is taxes plus the actual price, it remains broadly the same. So you would have seen that whenever there is a drop in global prices, even if it is a significant drop, like it is 40% drop, even in normal times, the price reduction that you and I pay is just 2-3 paisa or 20 paise or 1 rupee at the max, right? It never decreases very significantly. But when it is increased even a bit, when the global prices increases a bit, the government can easily mop up the excess revenue through by increasing the excise duty. So that's what is been happening. And again, it's I find it is not ethically wrong as well, because it gives really bad name to this term called market determined prices. So what happens is, in the popular imagination, the market prices then becomes a code word for ever increasing prices, right? So if you and I go and tell our parents that we are going to do something market determined, the only way they think is, man, you're going to increase prices of this throughout, right? But this is not how it is supposed to work. It is supposed to decrease prices when there is less scarcity of it, which happens in petrol and diesel, and that should be passed on to the consumers. But now everyone, because of government behavior of raising excise duties, we have accepted this that prices of oil and diesel are ever going to increase. So we are anchored to that number of 80, 82, 83. And hence, we don't even expect the government to make it 70 or 75 when actually it should. So that's how it is. And no one protests it either.
In fact, to give you some context, the share of crude oil and fuel products in the tax revenues for the union is approximately 20%. And the same number is for the states as well. Mm. So you see why there is no incentive for the union and the state governments to put petrol into the GST bucket, right?
Right.
So
and there is an additional one, right, Utkarsh? Because if you put in GST, you will require approval of all the approval of the state governments and the union government in the GST council. So that might take time. So why take that time? Just whenever you want to increase, it is a cash cow available for you. You can just increase it. The second advantage is, as I said, there is a portion of this which is in the form of cesses, right? And cesses are not shared with the state governments. So if the union government wants to make raise its revenue quickly, it can just raise this and it can appropriate that to itself, right? So that's why it happens.
Okay.
And, so, Utkarsh, there's one additional reason that I should mention. That is also this, there is a morality angle to this as well, right? The government can keep increasing these prices and always say that, you know, we are doing this because petroleum products cause pollution, and because they cause pollution, there should be a sort of a tax which eventually shifts our demand towards electric vehicles or other forms or public transport. And that's why, under the garb of this being acting moral and ethical, the government can indefinitely keep increasing the excise duty.
Okay, so it's something in the form of a sin tax that you pay for using petrol.
Exactly.
Okay. So coming to the higher order impacts, now if you raise the prices of petrol and diesel significantly, and given that these are inelastic products, would they lead to increased prices overall? And how do you think about inflation with when increasing taxes on fuel products?
Right. So there are around three effects, Utkarsh, that we need to understand. First effect is, it should, because these are essential for transport, for operating motors, for operating even pumps, which are diesel pumps, etc. Right. So there will be an increase in prices for all these three. Okay. That is in normal circumstances, right? So, but the government's logic in today's times is that the demand is so suppressed across the world that even if these prices increase, even if the prices of diesel and petrol increase, the eventual impact on the goods that you and I consume, let's say vegetables or fruits or grain, that will be minimal. So that's why the government is, in these circumstances, it is saying that it won't lead to higher inflation as of now, and that's why we can increase this excise duty. Okay.
So essentially, if I get this correctly, the person who is selling me the vegetables has reduced their margin. So even though the cost of that guy increases, I get it at the same price and the inflation does not happen.
Yeah, because there are very few buyers for that person, right?
Okay.
Because no one's buying, economy is in a poor situation, and the people will be postponing their consumption and things like that, right?
Correct.
Right. So that is their calculation, right? But what, there are two other effects which take place and which the government is ignoring. Okay. First, a higher prices will undermine competitiveness of Indian goods in the international market as well, right? Because it's not just that if, let's say if you want to export mangoes, there was a mango season, but all the inputs that you need for producing, transporting mangoes increase, the price of the mango even globally changes. You may say that domestically the situation is okay, etc. But if you compare it across the world, our competitiveness of Indian goods overall decreases, right, in a lot of sectors. So that is one effect that we should be very wary of, given that already Indian goods in many sectors are becoming less and less competitive. So that is important. The second thing is actually, and this is not understood by many, that rising in fuel taxes actually also leads to a higher subsidy payments for the government, because the prices of fertilizers increase, the prices of food increases, whatever the prices of irrigation, whatever little increases might be there that happens, that gets passed on to the government as well, because in the end, it has to also give subsidy on some of these products. Like it gives fertilizer subsidy to fertilizer companies. It gives food subsidy. So when the inputs to the fertilizer company increases, irrespective of whether the consumer pays for it or not, the fertilizer company is going to ask for a higher share of the subsidy payment, right? Which the government then pays. So basically, whatever money it raises through increase in fuel taxes, a portion of that will be carved off, will be offset by increasing subsidy payments as well. Okay. And also the revenue will be foregone, because even though it is inelastic, in some places the consumption will reduce. It is relatively inelastic, right? It is not perfectly inelastic. So the revenue that the government could have made by taxing those sectors will also decline, right? So these effects also come into play, and these are significant, and the government can't just ignore them.
Okay, so coming back to the undermining competitiveness in the export market, as you said, the government proclaims that it will receive 70,000 crores of additional revenue. So here we need to see that because of the decrease in competitiveness in the export market, there will be cost that a revenue that the Indian government will not be able to realize, which will actually result in the total revenue will be decreased because of the loss in revenue on the export market.
Exactly. So it won't be 70,000 crores. It will be less than that, because you are also foregoing some of the other ways that you could have raised money, right?
Correct. And when you talk about higher subsidy payments for fertilizers and foods, So isn't that why for a longer time there was more subsidy on diesel products, and diesel products were not deregulated even when the petrol products were? That was the logic behind it, right?
No, the logic behind diesel prices was again because diesel is used largely for transportation of goods, right? So trucks will use it, and so trucks and big vehicles will use it. So the logic was that if you increase diesel prices, the impact on other prices, let's say vegetables, fruits, grains, will be much higher compared to what you do with petrol, right? Which I totally agree that there shouldn't be any of this difference. You shouldn't subsidize diesel or petrol. And it is good now that the diesel price in Delhi, I think, is more than the petrol price, I guess.
Correct, but, for the first time.
Yeah, because, I mean, diesel is a more polluting fuel. So it is fine if it is even at the same levels. There's no sense in actually providing one preference for one over the other. But in general, this is, if we are increasing excise duties indefinitely, it is going to hurt the economy in the long run.
So coming to the political impact of this, so as we have discussed slightly, that fuel prices have always been a sticky issue with the citizens of the country. In fact, one of the reasons the UPA faced brickbats from the NDA government, NDA opposition, when they were in power, was because of increasing fuel prices. Now, what we have seen is here is that there are everyday smaller revisions to fuel prices as compared to, say, governments coming and announcing a 2 rupees or 3 rupees hike every few days. So does that play into the psyche of people, that people do not realize that things have been, prices have increased significantly because they have been dispersed across multiple days?
Yeah, that is actually what was done by the UPA government, Utkarsh, back then, because of these subsidies to diesel, etc., right? The government was incurring a huge loss and they wanted to increase the prices over the long time, right? To make it more market determined in the true sense, okay? Not in the sense that is being done now. So the way they came up with this, instead of increasing it in one shot, they started increasing it gradually, 50 paisa increase over many, many days, right? So that was aimed to reduce this perception that, you know, oil prices have increased suddenly. So that, I think, went off well because people sort of accepted that. The only problem of that was when this actual fuel price increase leads to inflation is when it becomes a really politically sticky issue, right? Because if you end up paying everything in double prices for the things that you consume on a daily basis, then it becomes a politically sticky point. But I guess the government's calculation at present is that they can increase it, and because the demand is low, the inflation won't increase as much, and hence they can suddenly increase by 8 rupees and people will not notice. So that's the calculation, I guess, and that's why it's being done in a sudden way now.
So India actually has the highest taxes on fuel as compared to many other countries. So as we talked about, India has a 69% tax on the pump price of the fuel that we see. Compared this to with US, where this is 19%, Canada is 33%, and so on and so forth. But so, can the government reduce taxes once it has already increased? And if yes, how can it be done? And what would an ideal world here look like?
I think the ideal world would be to just bring this under GST. And that will do two effects, right? Because once it is GST, the cascading effect will reduce. So you won't end up paying taxes on taxes and cesses on taxes. So that will reduce the eventual impact on the consumer, right? So for the government to raise the same amount of revenue, the price that the consumer has to pay will reduce by bringing it under GST. So that is one way. And if the government actually is worried about environmental effects, it can then over and above explicitly levy an environment duty on petrol and diesel over the GST rate that they decide, right? So that is possible to do. I think that is the way we should be moving ahead. Currently, because it is this nice little option available for state and union government they can just surreptitiously go and increase this, and the effect is so spread over a large number of people that they calculate that there wouldn't be any protest, right? But eventually this hurts the Indian economy and the individual. So I think moving to GST would be a better approach to doing this.
How do you think these incentives can be aligned in the political economy?
Yeah, I think that has to happen through public pressure, and that's why I think we are doing this podcast episode as well. I think it's important for us to realize how much of the effects we are bearing, and we should be demanding that if it is market determined prices, when the prices reduce, the effect should be passed on to the consumers as well, and how it affects India's competitiveness in the world market. As long as we keep batting for this, then the governments will be forced to take notice of this, right? I mean, GST happened, right? So because and lots of goods have come under GST. So if we keep sustained pressure over political formations, then I think we will eventually lead to this situation.
All right. So public pressure is probably one of the significant factors which can actually lead to effective change in this area. On that hopeful note, I think thank you for joining us on today's episode. Thank you, Pranav.
Thank you.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. I'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money and Intel. So, been a really exciting week on the network this week. We've had some really cool stuff. My old friend Vivek Lad was on Storytellers and Storysellers. Definitely do check that out. On Cyrus Said, we had Ashwin Sanghi on Thursday's episode. And Cyrus and myself did a cock and bull, just the two of us. That was fun as well on Monday. Do check that out. Masaba was on Advertising is Dead, which was another really, really strong episode from Varun. And on the sports front, both Edges and Sledges, Football had some really fun episodes. That's the Football Twaddle. Do check those out as well. And if you haven't been paying attention and you haven't been listening to Smile India in these times, I don't know why you aren't. It's the most uplifting show that you could listen to. It's a short, bite-sized piece of really positive things that happen in India. Do definitely check that out. And with that, we hope to see you again next week.
Namaskar, dear Bandhu. My name is Ashish Vidyarthi. These are truly challenging times. And in these times, we need hope. Do take time to listen to my podcast, Begin the Journey, available on IVM Podcasts website, app, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Remember, there is hope because there's one life and we are alive.